Wow, you and I are having a real treat of a day here. We got to read Ezekiel chapter 1, now we get to read Acts chapter 2 and 3. And again, this is all about the birth of the early church. After Jesus dies on the cross and rises from the dead for 40 days, he appears at various times, from time to time, to the apostles and teaches them about what's going to happen, instructs them what to do, and then he also, of course, is proving without a shadow of a doubt that it's him and that he has defeated death, broken the curse, and initiated this new covenant, a covenant where we are now sons of God. We can be indwelled by the Spirit of God, and we can do the works of God. Jesus said, those that believe on me, the works that I do shall they do also, and greater works than these shall they do, because I'm going to the Father, and then he's going to send back the living power, the Holy Spirit, to indwell us and move through us, so we become ambassadors for Christ, the light of the world, the salt of the earth, you know, just powerful dispensers of the beauty like of the Lord. Like Paul says, one place we have this treasure in our earthen vessels. In these little bodies, we've got the treasure, which is the power and the presence of God Almighty. Man, that's powerful stuff. So, on the day of Pentecost, so in other words, this is 50 days later. Pentecost is 50. Also, Jesus died, rose from the dead, appeared to them for 40 days, and then they prayed for 10 days. So 40 plus 10, that's 50. So on the day of Pentecost, which has happened, by the way, to be a great feast of the Jews. And so all the Jews had gathered into Jerusalem, you know, from all the different countries of the world to celebrate what this annual celebration. They were required by God to come back to Jerusalem. So the city's full of all these people from all over the world, and they're going to see something powerful in just a second. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place, like Jesus had told them to do. And suddenly there was a sound from heaven. They'd been praying for 10 days and waiting on God. Jesus had said, don't go till you get the power. And here they are praying. They don't know what they're expecting. They're just praying and waiting for God to show up. And suddenly there was a sound from heaven, like the roaring of a mighty windstorm. And that's something we were just reading about, a mighty windstorm in Ezekiel, weren't we? Well, there was the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. So here's 120 people, and there's a massive sound like a great wind, and suddenly they look around at each other, and they can, you know, and they can see there's one of them, and they can see 119 other people, and there's 119 flames sitting on top of each one's head, resting on each one of them. It says, and suddenly what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other tongues, other languages, as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. And friend, this gift is still available for all of us today. I've received it. Many of my friends have received it all around the world. You look at the pastors of the largest churches in the world, almost all of them have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They speak in tongues. They pray in tongues. That's where the real power comes right there, is when you start to pray in the Spirit. And so they began to speak in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. So what is speaking in tongues? It's a language that the Holy Spirit gives you the ability to speak. Not a language you know. It's not something that you suddenly remember that you heard as a child. Many times it's a language you've never heard in your life. In fact, the Bible says there are tongues of men and tongues of angels. So sometimes somebody speaks in tongues. It's a language, we're going to see this in a second, a language that's spoken somewhere else on the earth. And sometimes the language that people speak in tongues, it's a language that's a language of angels. It's not even spoken on the earth. Verse 5, at that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. Another one says there were devout pilgrims from all over the world. And that's actually a better translation. Okay, back at Acts chapter 2 again. I got disrupted over there in the office and had to pick up and move over here, which is fine, but I didn't want to lose that first part that I was talking to you about, that supernatural gift of speaking in tongues. So anyway, though, it says here in verse 6, it says, when they heard the loud noise, everyone came running. And it says, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. So here's 120 people in this upper room, the mighty rushing wind comes, the fire of the Holy Ghost comes and sits on each one of those 120, and the Spirit of God gave each one of them the ability to speak in a language they didn't understand in the natural. Here's all these devout Jews, these holy, consecrated Jews that had come from all around the world to Jerusalem on this feast day. And so they're assimilated into their own nations where they live, and they all speak different languages. And the apostles suddenly start to speak their languages, you know, the languages of all these people, supernaturally through the Holy Spirit. And they're speaking languages that are known on the earth. Again, there's some that are known on earth that you sometimes speak in tongues, and sometimes you speak in a language that nobody on the earth knows. Anyway, so it says these men came running from everywhere, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed, and they said, "How can this be? These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages. And here we are, Parthians and Medes and Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, the province of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the areas of Libya around Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. And we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things that God has done." And I just have to share this testimony. Many, many, many years ago, when I was in Bible school up in Dallas, Texas, we had a guest speaker at our chapel service. There were about 1,000 students in this large auditorium, and one of my friends, well, I was sitting up in the balcony, and he was sitting down in the middle of the floor, and during the worship service, he gave a message in tongues. He began to speak out in an unknown language, and so we all stopped, you know, respectfully to allow him to minister and manifest that gift of the Holy Spirit. And so then it was just silent. We were all waiting for someone else through the Spirit to interpret what he had said. And lo and behold, there was a black gentleman, very nicely dressed in a suit. He was up on the platform. I'd never seen him before. He turned out to be our guest speaker that day. And he stepped up to the microphone and he pointed out in the crowd and he said, young man, he said, "Do you know what you just said?" And my friend just kind of hollered back, you know, from the middle of the crowd. He said, "No, sir, I was just speaking in tongues." And he said, "Well, let me tell you, you just spoke my language." He was from Africa. And he said, and then he interpreted it for us, not through a gift of the Spirit, but through his natural knowledge. And I'll never forget, although it's been some 40 years ago almost now, that he said, "What you just said was the bells are ringing out the glory of God. Praise the Lord." Of course, the roof just came off the place. I mean, we just were so excited to see what God has done. And so here on the day of Pentecost, it says all these men are saying, "We all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done." And they stood there amazed and perplexed. And they said, "What can this mean?" they asked each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, "They're just drunk, that's all." Now, you know what? That's about how absurd it is when people try to attack the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, and Christians for believing in the gospel. They can say something just that absurd. "Oh yeah, these guys are speaking a supernatural language because they're drunk." How does that figure? How is there any logic to that? Verse 14, "Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles. And he shouted to the crowd, 'Listen carefully.'" Again, it's a massive crowd. Imagine Peter just speaking out. He's boldly preaching to all these Jews from all over the world. He says, "Listen carefully, all of you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem. Make no mistake about this." He said, "These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that." So the Holy Spirit fell on Pentecost 9 o'clock in the morning. And he said, "We're not drunk." He says, "No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel, saying, 'In the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit upon all people.'" And by the way, the prophet says he would do that in the last days. And so that day was the beginning of the last days. And you and I are living in the same last days. And we have access to the same experiences that the early church had. these experiences have not passed away. I've received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and spoken in tongues. I've seen many miracles over my Christian life. Certainly never saw any before I accepted Jesus or before I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, but I've seen many, many since, because Jesus said, you'll do the same works that I do and even greater because I am going to the Father. And the rest of that, he didn't say it right then, but later on he explained that when I go to the Father, I'll send back the Holy Spirit. And so when we have the Holy Spirit indwelling in us and faith, we have that power and that ability to do these kinds of things. Does it happen every day, every moment? Of course not. Any more than Jesus healed people every day, every moment. There's times he slept, he ate, he just had, you know, days of rest and whatnot. But there were many, many times that he did miracles through his faith in the Father. And so Peter says, in the last days, God says, I'll pour out my Spirit upon who? All people. All people have the ability to receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He said, I'll pour out my Spirit upon all people. Even your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions and your old men will dream dreams. And then verse 18, in those days I'll pour out my Spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. Praise the Lord. When I got filled with the Holy Spirit, it was the same day that I got saved. I didn't know up from down. I didn't know anything about religion at all, but some people pray with me. I got filled with the Holy Spirit and they said, hey, come see us in Dallas. And I said, I'll be there in 2 weeks. And I wondered, they got on the bus and they left town. They left LA where I was. And I said, why in the world did I say that? Well, about 10 days later, a friend of mine called and said, hey, Warren, how'd you like to drive to Fort Worth with me? And I said, well, is that anywhere near Dallas? And he said, absolutely. It's right down the road from Dallas. If you come with me, you can help me drive to Dallas to see my uncle. And then to Fort Worth, I mean. And he said, when we get to Fort Worth, you can take my car and go see your friends in Dallas. And friend, 2 weeks to the day, I was in Dallas seeing those people. How did I say that? I said it by the Spirit, didn't even know what I was doing, but just said, I'll see you there in 2 weeks. And there it was. And so he says, your young men, your young women, they will all prophesy. He says, and I will cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Now he's skipping over and talking about the last days. These are the beginning of the last days. Now he's talking about the last days when Jesus Christ will come back again. The world will end as we know it. He says, I'll cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark and the moon will turn blood red before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. And all the Jews knew what he was talking about. They talked about that great day of the Lord. You'll see that over and over in the Old Testament prophets, meaning the day of, now we understand that as the day of the rapture of the church. They just understood it as the day when the Messiah would return and all the wrongs would be made right. And everybody that had sinned would be called into account for their sins. And so he says all these signs will happen before that great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. But here's the point. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. So whether you're Jew or Gentile, Muslim, or, you know, Baha'i faith or whatever faith you are, if you will call on, or no faith at all, atheist like I used to be, I didn't believe God existed until I heard about Jesus and that just somehow registered in my heart and made sense. I believed in Jesus and called on his name. I was born again. And it says everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, whatever situation you're in, says if you call on his name, you will be saved. And friend, you need to accept that by faith. Just believe that if you call on Jesus, you will be saved. And then in verse 22, he says, people of Israel, again, Peter speaking here, people of Israel, listen, God publicly endorsed Jesus the Nazarene by doing powerful miracles, wonders, and signs through him. As you well know, all the Jews knew that Jesus had done all of these miracles. And he says, verse 23, but God knew what would happen, and his prearranged plan was carried out when Jesus was betrayed. With the help of lawless Gentiles, you nailed him to a cross and killed him. And so there's been a debate over the years, you know, who's responsible for the death of Jesus? Was it the Jews or was it the Gentiles? Well, Peter says it was the Jews with the help of the Gentiles. And the fact of the matter is Jesus died for every man's sin. Nobody put him on that cross. Nobody actually had the authority. Jesus said, you don't have the authority to crucify me. He says, the Father has sent me here for this purpose. You want to blame somebody for the crucifixion? Blame God the Father. because it was his plan, but it was his plan in order to save you. Amen. Amen. But Jesus, so Peter said, Peter, who was a Jew, says to the Jews, you betrayed him, you nailed him to a cross, and you killed him. Verse 24, but God released him from the horrors of death and raised him back to life, for death could not keep him in its grip. King David said this about him, about Jesus. So David was a prophet and said prophetically about Jesus. He said, I see that the Lord is always with me. I'll not be shaken, for he's right beside me. Verse 26, no wonder my heart's glad and my tongue shouts his praises. My body rests in hope. For you'll not leave my soul among the dead or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. And so David said, by the Spirit, you're not going to leave me in the grave, not going to leave me among the dead, nor will you allow your Holy One. Now he's talking to God the Father through the Spirit, King David is, and he's saying, you, Father, will not allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. Who's the Holy One? That's Jesus. And so David, 1,500 years before Jesus lived, prophesies that the Messiah would come. He would be in the grave, but he would not rot in the grave. And isn't that amazing? That's exactly what happened. Jesus died on the cross, laid in the tomb for 3 days, didn't rot in the grave. He rose from the dead. Verse 28, you've shown me the way of life, and you will fill me with joy in your presence. Verse 29, dear brothers, think about this. You can be sure that the patriarch David wasn't referring to himself, for he died, he was buried, and his tomb is still here among us. But he was a prophet, and he knew that God had promised with an oath that one of David's own descendants would sit on his throne. David was looking into the future, prophetically, and speaking of the Messiah's resurrection. He was saying that God wouldn't leave him among the dead or allow his body to rot in the grave. God raised Jesus from the dead, and we are all witnesses of this. He's standing there with the other 11 apostles saying, we are all witnesses that Jesus has been raised from the dead. We saw it with our own eyes. We have seen him. We know he's alive. Verse 33, and now he's exalted to the place of highest honor in heaven. Praise Jesus. He's at God's right hand. Praise the Lord. And the Father, as he had promised, gave Jesus the Holy Spirit to pour out upon us, just as you see and hear today. For David himself never ascended into heaven, and yet he said, the Lord said to my Lord, so Lord, my Father said to the Lord Jesus, the Lord said to my Lord, sit in the place of honor at my right hand. Wow, can you imagine? David in the Spirit saw this 1,500 years before Jesus ever came to earth. And he says, so the Lord said to my Lord, sit in the place of honor at my right hand until I humble your enemies, making them a footstool under your feet. Friend, if you ever wonder, don't worry about the welfare of Jesus Christ or his church, because the Bible tells us every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father, and it is going to be exactly as the Bible says it will be. Verse 36, so let everybody in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus whom you crucified. Peter was not at all scared or ashamed to tell the Jews, you crucified him. And he says, let everybody in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. Peter's words pierced their hearts. And they said to him and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? In other words, okay, we believe you. Jesus is the Son of God. He did die on the cross, and we were responsible for it. And so now what do we do? What should we do? Peter says, each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God. And friend, if you're not saved yet, you need to get saved, and here's how you do it. You repent of your sins. You tell God, I'm sorry. I've been going the wrong direction. I'm going to turn around right now. I'm going to go the other direction. I've been living for myself. I've been living for my friends. I've been living for my job or whatever, but I've not been living for you. And now I'm going to turn to you, Lord, and live for you. It says, repent of your sins, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Now, friend, baptism doesn't save you, but it's the first thing you should do when you get saved. Amen. He says, repent of your sins, turn to God, and then be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And then he says, see, and every one of us should do the first and the second and the third. We should repent, We should be baptized, and he says, then you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So everybody listening, everybody watching today, if you haven't yet received the gift of the Holy Spirit, you should begin to receive that. So how do I receive that? By faith, same way you get saved. You just ask him for it, and then you accept it by faith. You see, when you ask Jesus to save your soul, you tell God the Father, I repent of my sins, and I'm receiving Jesus now. You might have bells and whistles go off inside your heart. You might cry. You might laugh. You might not feel anything, but you accept it by faith. And the same thing with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When they laid hands on me and I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I felt power, literally felt power like I'd been plugged into an electric wall socket. I felt power go through my body, and I knew I'd gotten something. I didn't know what it was. I was very ignorant, but I knew I'd gotten something. But you know what, though? God bless those that get hands laid on them, or they just ask in their own home, and they receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit by faith. They just say, thank you, Father God, I have it. I have it, I have it, I have it, just like they said when they got saved. Lord, I have it. I don't feel any different, but I know I'm saved because I believe in your word. Amen. So Peter says, repent, be baptized in the name of Jesus, and then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you. Now here's Peter talking to these Jews from all over the world. This promise is to you and to your children and even to the Gentiles, to all who are far off, all who have been called by the Lord our God. And so this was in the last days. We're in the last days, and the promise was for everybody, and it's for you, friend. And then Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all his listeners, save yourselves from this crooked and corrupt generation. And those who believed what Peter said were baptized in water. Now, it doesn't say this here, but I assume, because he already told them, repent and be baptized, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it says they repented and they were baptized. So what happened? They would have received the gift of the Holy Spirit that day also. And it says, and they were added to the church that day about 3,000 in all. Now, there may have been many more than 3,000 that listened to Peter that day, but there were about 3,000 that believed and accepted what he had to say. Verse 42, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, and to fellowship, and to sharing in meals. In other words, there's so much love in them, and unity, and community in them, and we ought to aspire to that as well. Amen. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, and to fellowship, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer, and a deep sense of awe came over them all. And the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders, and all the believers met together in one place, and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions, and they shared the money with those who were in need. They worshiped together at the temple every day, and they met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and they shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. And Lord, let it be so. Let it be just exactly like that today, all around the world. I pray that God would work in our hearts, that we would love Jesus with all of our hearts. We would trust God. We'd repent of our sins and live for God, be filled with the Holy Spirit, and be bold witnesses for Jesus Christ, and then live in unity and generosity and deep love and fellowship with each other as we're supposed to. Amen. Amen. Okay, we'll get on into Acts chapter 3.